Naima, a British convert of whom the British newspaper The Daily Telegraph wrote, "That Muslim woman could be happier than you." She is also the chief editor of Sisters magazine, as well as a prize-winning author of many books, including the popular From My Sister's Lips. She told me that when she was still searching, she went to an evangelical Christian church, attended the ceremony, and then wanted to know more.
I went back to the back where they were taking people who had said that they accept Jesus Christ as their savior. And I said, I want to know how I can know this is the truth. What's the proof? And she said to me, "You just have to believe. You just have to believe." And I said, "Well, I can't do that. I need something more than just blind faith." So I left that, went to university, and my first encounter with Islam that I became aware of was when I came to Egypt. And interestingly enough, it was actually seeing women wearing hijab that made me very, very, very upset. I disapproved of it 100%. Consider myself a feminist, cosmopolitan feminist, and the sight of these women covering themselves, I felt sorry for them. I thought, you know, why do their men make them wear this? You know, what's this all about? And then one day, we went to a festival, and there was a lady there. She was wearing a hijab. And she was very, very beautiful, mashallah. She had one of those faces which radiated light. She was a very lovely lady. And I thought, no, I'm going to ask her. I'm not going to assume. I'm going to ask her why she wears that thing on her head. So I said to her, "You are so beautiful. Why? Why do you cover yourself?" And she smiled at me and she said, "Because I want to be judged for what I say and what I do, not what I look like." And for me, I'd never, ever heard that idea. Ever in my life. And it made me really start thinking about my lifestyle, my ideas, my values. And I thought to myself, when I saw these women, I saw them as weak. But now when she says that to me, when she says that she doesn't need male attention, she doesn't need male approval, I think maybe I'm the one who's weak and she's the one who's strong. And I wonder whether I could be as strong as that. So when I went back to England, I got a copy of the Quran and I started reading it. And I said to myself, I'm going to read the Bible and I'm going to read the Quran because maybe now is the time in my life that I need to make a choice for my spiritual side, which I had been ignoring all this time. I never got around to the Bible in the end. I just read the Quran and it made sense to me. The lifestyle choices made sense to me. It seemed like a very sane and healthy and safe type of life. And I thought if I ever have children, I would want to raise them in a strong belief system and in an environment that fosters the best that is within them. And that was the end of one journey and the start of another journey within the deen, within the religion of Islam.
Personal question. Why did you choose the niqab?
I actually liked the niqab. I liked the idea of privacy. I liked the idea of my face not being on show for just anybody to see. I remember specifically one incident that made me decide to start covering my face is when I was going home. It was quite late and I was going home from work on the train. And I was standing up because there were no seats available. And some men who were sitting on the chairs were staring at me. And I remember feeling very upset and angry, thinking, why do they think they have the right to just look at me, you know, and in my face? And I said, I don't like this. You know, I want to be able to choose who sees me and sees that part of me and who doesn't. So I started covering with the niqab then, just on and off, not all the time. But the time that I actually took on the niqab as an act of worship, which is how I see it now, not just something that's convenient or something that, you know, helps me achieve certain ends, was when I went to the doctors and I did some tests and there was a fear that I may be ill. And at that time, I was just newly married. It was a very wonderful time, mashallah. And I went to the doctors and everything, I was given the all clear. And I remember walking down the road, it was in East London, and saying to Allah, to God, thank you for everything that you have made my life into right here, right now. How can I praise you more? How can I worship you more? How can I thank you more? The niqab, I don't see it as obligatory, but it's considered by many scholars as something that is recommended. It's rewardable. It's something that you do to gain the pleasure of God. And I thought, this is something that is not hard for me. Why don't I do it? This would be something that I'm doing extra to show my gratitude to God. And that's when I actually started to wear the niqab sort of full-time. The media needs symbols. It needs symbols of oppression. It needs symbols of backwardness. And it's chosen niqab as its symbol of oppression and backwardness and call to gender rights and things like this. So in terms of the media, there's not really much that one can do sort of, you know, to tackle the media, except for trying as much as possible to put positive images of women in niqab out there. You know, the more women we have in niqab who are achieving great things, who are going out there and making a difference, the more the public perception of niqab starts to change. It upsets me when people see the niqab as something that holds women back. I don't believe that. Yes, there are restrictions and there are things that are more difficult for you, but it depends on who you are as a person. Because if you are hardworking, if you are determined, if you believe in yourself, if you have great ideas, if you're a people person, the niqab makes no difference, because people will get over that by the force of your personality. I believe that because that's been my experience. You know, within my work, I've gone into schools, I've lectured in university halls, I've been on television, on radio, etc., you know, talking about other things, not only the niqab. And at the end of the day, if you're an intelligent woman, you're intelligent whether your face is showing or not. If you're funny, you're funny whether your face is covered or not. If you're kind, you're kind whether your face is covered or not. And it's up to society to be open to receiving what women in niqab have to offer. And it's also up to women in niqab to go out there and make a space for themselves and make that space where they can contribute to society.